things. It's been a while since I've uploaded something, but I'm back again, and I've been working on a Christmas themed video series, of which I will be uploading videos in the next couple of weeks, so I hope you like that. And in the first video, I'm going to show you how to throw a Christmas tree on the potter's wheel, and later on in the video I will also show you some fun techniques on how to decorate them, and I will also be glazing them and show you the final result. So keep on watching and I hope you like it. I start off with centering the clay. As you can see, I wet the bed and then I attach the piece of clay. I first start with pressing the clay towards the middle, and I also cone it up and push it down, and you can repeat this multiple times if necessary. Then I start opening up the form by pushing my middle finger into the middle, and what's a bit different about this tree is that I'm going to push my finger all the way down to the bed, so I don't make a bottom at all and just get rid of all the clay at the bottom. If you can't get everything away with just your finger, you can also use a wooden knife like I'm doing here, and I just cut off a little bit of the excess clay that's still on the bed. After that, I make sure that the clay is still centered by holding my hands around it and just pressing it to the middle. When I've done that, I start to pull up the walls. As you can see, I hold a sponge in my right hand and I hold my left hand on the inside of the piece. And I just press with my right hand towards my left hand and make an upwards movement. Here you can see the wheel speed for my throwing. As you can see, I move my hands very slowly and the wheel itself is spinning slow as well. I try to move my hands as consistent as possible to keep the piece nice and centered. And I move my hands all the way up to the rim. To prevent the cylinder from becoming too wide, I hold my hands around it and push them to the middle while moving them upwards. I keep repeating this, so I pull up the walls of the cylinder and I make sure it doesn't become too wide. The top shouldn't become too wide because I will be closing the top of the form into a point to get the shape of a tree. When I have made the cylinder as high as I can get it, I slowly start to close the form. I hold my hands around the clay and move them towards each other while moving up. This way the opening at the top becomes smaller. I keep repeating this movement. You shouldn't try to close the form too fast, otherwise the clay might fold when pushing it inwards. It isn't a problem if the top of the cylinder isn't fully centered anymore. The top will be closed, so it will be easy to take some clay off the top to make it centered again. I do this when the form is fully closed. When the opening at the top becomes smaller, the clay becomes thicker. You can use this extra thickness to make the tree a bit taller by pushing the extra clay upwards. I do this by pressing with my right index finger and I again hold my left hand on the inside. I like to hold my left thumb against my right hand to make it easier to move my hands at the same time. I keep repeating this and keep pushing the clay to the top. I also use both of my hands to push more clay to the top and slowly close the form. Now that the top is almost fully closed, I press some clay all the way from the bottom to the top and push my fingers against each other at the top, so that the shape fully closes. I like to use a straight loamer to make the tree into a fluent shape, and it also helps me to get rid of the slip on the tree. Then I grab my wooden knife and I cut off some excess clay at the bottom, and I also clean the bed. Then I use sponge to make the shape as smooth as possible. Now you can either leave the shape like this and decorate it in a different way, which I'll be showing you later, but you can also make some fun texture on the wheel itself. I do this by using my flat wooden knife. I hold it a little bit tilted and push the top part of the tool into the clay like this. I make lines like this all over the tree. You can of course decide yourself whether you want a lot of small lines or maybe just a few deeper lines. As you can see, little pieces of clay get stuck on the texture, but this isn't a problem. I will be removing them later on. I first make all the lines and then I get rid of the biggest pieces with a knife. After this, I take my sponge and smooth out the edges. If you still have some little pieces of clay stuck in the lines, you can grab your wooden knife again and smooth it out. And then go over it again with a sponge, and then the throwing part is finished. I forgot to record it, but I would recommend to make a little hole in your tree somewhere at the bottom. This will prevent your tree from cracking while drying. When the tree is dried for a day and it's leather hard, I cut it off the bed with a wire tool. As you can see, the clay is still a bit thick at the part where it was attached to the throwing bed. I like to cut it off with a little knife. You could also trim it on the wheel, but I think this is the easiest and faster way to do it. After I have cut off the excess clay, I use a sponge to smooth out the part I just cut. I also like to smooth out the outside of the rim so it isn't sharp. Then I start closing the little hole I made. When it's very small, you might be able to close it by just rubbing your sponge over it, but the hole I made was a little bit too big, so I fill it up with a little bit of clay. And I smooth this out with a sponge. And then the first tree is finished and ready to dry for the biscuit fire. With this next tree, I'm going to show you how to make holes in it. As you can see, I left the tree smooth with throwing and didn't make any texture. These holes can be very fun for Christmas because you can put a little light inside of it. I would not recommend to put a candle in it because the clay will get very hot, so I recommend using electric lights on battery. As you can see, I start with making a straight line of holes. I don't measure anything, but what could help you with making the line straight are the little lines or sponge made on the wheel. Just pick one of the lines and keep this as the bottom of the holes. After the first line of holes, I make two more lines. Here's a bit of a closer look at how exactly I make the holes. I first place the top of the tool on the tree where I want to make the hole, and then I twist the tool while pushing it inwards, and then I pull it out as straight as possible. With the tools that I use, the clay gets stuck in the hole maker, so I have to take this out every time before I make the next hole. After I've made three lines of holes, I grab a smaller tool for smaller holes. You can of course make any pattern you want with any size of holes you'd like. I prefer to use two sizes of holes because with more sizes the holes will become bigger and look less elegant in my opinion. As you can see, I add a line of small holes above and underneath the bigger holes. After I've done this, I make the pattern a little bit more interesting. As you can see, I make a hole and then leave a space closed, so that you get these little triangles. I would recommend counting the amount of holes you have before doing this, because it only works when it's an even number. If it's not, but it is dividable by 3, you could make bigger triangles by making 2 holes and leave 1 closed space and then add an extra hole on top of the 2 holes, if you know what I mean. On top of the little triangles, I make an extra hole and then I make another hole on top of the previous hole, but I leave a closed space again. You can just play with these patterns and see what you'd like to do. I don't think out the whole pattern at front, but I just see what I like along the way. The small hole maker left some of the pieces of clay in the holes. I easily get rid of these by pushing them inwards. This is also a reason why I would recommend to not give your tree a bottom. When I'm done making the holes, I like to smooth out all of the edges of the holes, because these become quite sharp. This takes some time, but I think it's worth it, because it will leave you with a nicer result. So what I do is wipe the sponge around every hole, and after I have done a part, I go over it as a hole to flatten the little bit of excess clay you get from the rims. And then this tree is finished as well and ready to dry before biscuit fire. I'm decorating the next tree by carving. I'm making lines from the top all the way down to the bottom. I do this by placing my tool on the top of the tree and then make a straight movement to the bottom. To get the line nice and straight, it is best to move your hand quite fast in one movement. I found it easiest to leave the tree on the table and tilt it while carving. If your tree is a bit smaller, you might be able to hold it in your hand the whole time, but mine was a bit too big for that, since you have to push quite hard while carving. So this works the best for me. I first divided the tree in 4 equal parts and then made lines in between those lines. After those lines, I made lines in between the lines again. I started these lines a bit lower at the top so I wouldn't carve into the part I already carved. You can of course make as much variations on carving as you like. You could for example make shorter lines and divide the tree in different parts. It's also possible to use different sized carving tools which can help with making a nice pattern. After having carved the entire tree, I smooth it out with a sponge. I like to do this to make sure that all the lines are nice and smooth and not sharp. The glaze will still be able to break on top of it, but it wouldn't break too much. On to the next tree. I will be decorating this last tree with slip. Slip is a clay mixed with water. You can buy it as a slip, but you could just as well make slip by mixing your own clay with water. I use the slip on the bottom of my water bucket that I use for throwing. I put the slip into this little bottle. It has a metal top which makes it easy to apply very small amounts. It's my idea to make little dots all over the tree, and I'm trying to make a bit of a faded effect. I do this by first applying a lot of dots near to each other at the bottom. When you can't get slip out of the little bottle, there is probably some air in it. You can easily help this by shaking it, but of course please don't do this above your own work. After applying a lot of dots at the bottom, I start working upwards. When going up, I place the holes further from each other. After I've gone all the way up to the top, I go over the whole tree to see if there are bigger open spaces to make some extra dots. I found that the fade between the closed dots at the bottom to the middle part wasn't as good as I wanted, so I added more dots to make the fade better. And then the last tree is finished. When all the trees dried, I put them in the oven for biscuit fire at 1020 degrees Celsius. I'll now show you how I glaze my trees. You can of course use the glaze you already have, but this might give you some inspiration. For the first tree, I start with applying 3 coats of Honey Flux from Emco. After this, I make lines with Tourmaline from Emco. To do this, I use a thin brush with long hairs and let the tree spin on this little turntable. I don't apply Tourmaline on the bottom line because I was afraid it would drip off, but I later on discovered that it wouldn't have. After the lines have dried, I apply a second layer. When the glaze is dry, I clean the bottom of the tree by using this wet piece of fabric. I do this with all the trees, otherwise the glaze will get stuck onto the kiln shelf. And here are some pictures of the final result. As you can see, the colors blended nicely and the glaze broke on top of the texture. I also made a tree without any texture. I glazed it with Ancient Copper from Emco. I'm applying 3 coats of glaze. I use a white brush, this makes it easier to apply the glaze evenly and it goes faster. It isn't the glaze I would normally go for, but for this Christmas tree I like how it turned out. As you can see, there are small copper crystals in the glaze and it's very shiny as well. I'm going to do the Northern Light glazing combination on the tree with the holes. Because I do this combination so often, I have a bucket of obsidian from Emco. I added water so that I can dip the piece. As you can see, the smaller holes get filled up with glaze. I use a straw to open them by blowing. If you're not able of dipping the obsidian, I'd recommend to apply 3 coats. I have a full instruction about this glaze combination, maybe you'd like to check it out. The next color I'm using is Indigo Float. I apply 2 coats at the top part of the tree. Then I apply 2 coats of Smoky Merlot on the middle part of the tree. The last color I apply is Seaweed. I brush this onto the bottom part of the tree, also 2 layers. It's important you let the glaze dry before you add another layer. This is what the piece looks like after it's been fired. The colors melted nicely into each other. I'm glazing the carved tree with Celadon Green from Watts. I applied 2 coats. I absolutely love this glaze because it always comes out the way I want it to, and it works great with texture. As you can see, the glaze has a very bright color and it broke on the texture. I'm glazing the last tree with the glaze Lavender from Emco. It's a celadon glaze, which means that it's a bit see-through and it works great with texture. I applied 3 layers of glaze. And here is the final result. As you can see, the glaze broke nicely on top of the little dots. That was it for this video. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you liked it and learned something new from it. If so, please give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so yet. And if you're going to make these trees yourself and you're going to post them on Instagram, please tag me at @carlceramic so I can see your trees, because that would be awesome. I hope to see you on the next video, which will be uploaded on Friday. I will be uploading on Mondays and Fridays for the next few weeks, and I will just see how that goes and how long I can keep up with this uploading schedule. But for now, I'd like to wish you a very nice day, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!